I'm going to talk about a couple of issues today. I'm going to start with, first of all, an overview of legal and ethical issues in integrative medicine, just to kind of set the stage for the rest of the day. Then I'm going to hone in on some of the scope of practice hot buttons that Dr. Garcia identified, and how, as a lawyer, I start to think about how we might begin to move forward. I'll talk a little bit about the non-licensed providers, and then move into specific issues of liability and discipline. How do we define standard of care, and what legal and ethical issues emerge in spiritual care? This is a topic that Dr. Garcia asked me to address. Can people see the slides in the back? Could we turn the lights down just a little bit, just to make that clearer? Can somebody mention that to Ann Walsh in the back? They're working on it. Thank you. Okay, now as a lawyer, it's very important that I ask you to read the fine print. So by way of background, we will be including material relevant to other professions such as MDs. The legal and ethical strategies that I offer will be describing a very general framework. Therefore, when it comes to the Q&A, without any legal research, it's like giving kind of an internet diagnosis. So, you know, we have to proceed cautiously because some of the questions that Dr. Garcia raised are very broad and will only be resolved after much discussion. So I also have to warn you that portions of the talk may not contain any humor whatsoever. When I look across integrative medicine broadly defined at some of the key legal issues, they really pervade all of the professions. Issues such as licensure and credentialing, who can practice, what do you need to practice, what do you need to stay current, what's the scope of practice, what can each profession do, what are the limits, what are the outer boundaries. What about the all-pervasive malpractice liability concern? Huge topic, particularly in medical audiences where physicians contemplate expanding their practice to include complementary medicine. What about professional discipline and how does that interact, dovetail with the preceding topics? And then the last three, which we won't get into very much, right of access to treatments, reimbursement, and healthcare fraud. And these issues, I've written about them across different medical specialties, from cardiology to dermatology to mental health care, oncology, pain management, pediatrics, and other specialties. And honing in, for example, in licensure, some of the key questions to ask, is the therapist licensed? If not, is there a statute authorizing a non-licensed provider to practice? Is the modality within scope of practice? Malpractice, did the therapy fail the standard of care? Was it below standard care? And as a result, did it cause the patient injury? And finally, could use of the therapy be considered unprofessional conduct? The answer to all these, of course, is it depends. You'll notice a very thick volume of rules there, thicker than your handout. And oftentimes I'm asked to do kind of a legal audit of a practice, and I'll go through each of these areas, so I'm just taking you through them in a very broad way. So is the provider appropriately licensed, properly credentialed? The same question, whether it's an MD, DO, an allied health professional, an acupuncturist, a chiropractor, massage therapist, etc. And then, of course, the unlicensed providers in a couple of states. And I might talk in those states about the legal risks of the non-licensed provider, things like unlicensed practice of medicine. I'll get into that in a few minutes. Or of another healthcare profession, civil and criminal fraud, and wire and mail fraud. And the last two have actually, I've seen them used in states even where non-licensed providers are allowed to practice, which is a way of saying that the law is really very, very much emerging and still kind of in search of definition in a lot of these areas. Now, is the provider within the legally authorized scope of practice as somebody diagnosing and treating disease, which they're not allowed to do? What about dietary supplements, mental health counseling, and other boundary areas between the professions? Again, a gray area. Is the provider following standard of care, offering informed consent? Very critical, are they substituting an ineffective CAM therapy for a necessary conventional therapy? Are they injuring the patient by delaying necessary conventional care? Are they documenting the medical record correctly? Are they meeting any board guidelines, including documentation, regarding CAM therapies? Are they supervising or being supervised as required? Are they appropriately referring to and from CAM and medicine? If including dietary supplements, making appropriate recommendations with proper warnings of potential adverse events? Are they avoiding false and misleading claims, properly coding and billing, and ensuring that care can be medically necessary? Again, this is just to give you a very broad kind of overview as I go through the legal audit of areas that we'll want to look into. And I've been speaking to people and representing clients from across a broad spectrum of professions, from MDs again to DCs, LACs, dietary supplement manufacturers. I've had a lot of calls from lawyers, which is a good thing, because when lawyers call, I know I'm doing something right. I can provide expertise. Medical centers, integrative care centers, health plans, clinics, and so on. So what we're going to do today is, it says every American victimized in this system will be able to sue in this system. So we're going to take you through the U.S. healthcare labyrinth and lead you into the legal labyrinth, where there's a dollar sign in at the center, a patient-oriented chart cartoon. Few physicians among us are eminent for their skill. Quacks abound like locusts in Egypt. Can anybody identify the date and the source of this quote? Or take a guess? This is actually a historian from the 1700s, and that sentiment was echoed by the medical societies of the day. And in order to resolve this problem, which is still current almost 250 years later, they decided that people could no longer offer whatever therapies they were taught by their grandparents or their culture, but they had to get a license. And back then, we had the same debate. We had the regular physicians versus the irregular physicians, as they styled themselves. And the regulars were the people who treated George Washington with leeches and the therapies of the day, emetics. And the regulars were people who practiced, irregulars practiced botanical medicine, Native American plant medicine, and other precursors to the natural health movement, all the way evolving into the grams with the graham crackers and the cornflakes. And so you see these two movements really existed in parallel all through American history, all the way back from the colonies. Now, the first statute really comes more or less out of New York, which imposes the requirement of licensure to practice medicine. But what's interesting is, how do they define medicine? You have this whole world of healing, and we're going to take a part of it and say, for this, you need a license. And so the medical licensing laws, the very first statutes in the 1750s, define medicine as diagnosis and treatment of disease. And these are three very broad terms. And potentially anybody who's doing some kind of healing falls into this statute. So chicken soup for the soul, that would be treatment. Okay, if you think very broadly. And just to show you this, all the way back in the early 20th century, go to jail for chiropractic becomes a slogan for the profession. Because if you were worth your salt as a chiropractor, you would be duly indicted, prosecuted, and practicing behind bars, because people said that that constituted the practice of medicine. And in 1973, as acupuncture was starting to gain popularity in the United States, people asked the question, well, is this the practice of medicine? And there is an unlicensed gentleman in New York named Mr. Amber, and he argued that he wasn't practicing Western medicine. He was simply assessing imbalance of qi. But the New York court said that this was indeed medical practice, and it said that the licensing statute referred to all of the healing arts. Indeed, diagnosis meant any sizing up of a patient's mental or physical status, or even determining the existence of a disharmony based upon the disequilibrium of yin and yang. So very, very broad statutory language. So as a result, the different professions start to vie in the state legislatures for licensure, chiropractic being the earliest, with a lot of actually successes with public figures, moving on to naturopathy, massage therapy very late, and then finally acupuncture. So this gives you a broad overview of who's practicing across states. And you can see that, by and large, the massage therapists have the largest slice of the pie, all the way down to the naturopathic physicians. These are probably old figures. The figures are a little bit dated. Otherwise, we would have half the people would be in this room. But you can just see the percentages here. Now, you can also compare this to the number of allopathic providers to give you a sense that the registered nurses at 2.5 million, by and large, outnumber everybody else. Now, another way to look at this is who's licensed across states. And again, you can see chiropractors in every state, massage therapy and acupuncture in working their way up toward all of the states, and the naturopathic medicine, 14 states, more or less, depending on how you count and which states you include. Yet another way to look at this is to actually go through. Can you see that slide in the back? Could you, is somebody coming to dim the lights a little bit? They're working on it. Okay. Have to use your imagination here, or move up if you need to. But what this does is it shows you the statutes actually listed by section and by state. And so you can pick a state, for example, Colorado, and you can look across and you can actually track which is whether they have a statute and what code section to look at. And the thing that you'll notice is that while the medical licensing statutes are fairly uniform, and they really haven't changed much since the late 19th century, these vary. They're pretty much all over the map, so that every state has its own definition. And there's some complications because mind-body providers, are they conventional providers or alternative providers? Does it depend on the modality that they're treating? What about guided imagery, hypnotherapy? What about counselors? What about nurses offering healing touch or pastoral counselors laying on hands? Where does all this fall? Yet another complication is that there's mandatory licensure, which prohibits somebody from offering a service unless they have the license. Then there's title licensure, which means somebody can only offer the service if they have, they can only use the title if they have the license. For example, anybody can offer counseling, but only a licensed psychologist can use the term psychologist. Next is registration, which is a much lower threshold. You merely have to register your name, address, and sometimes your training with a state agency, and people can then submit a complaint to the agency. And then there's an exemption. For example, Shiatsu and Reiki might be exempted from the requirement of getting a license for massage therapy. So it's very confusing to the public. You know, am I going to a license provider? Well, is it mandatory? Is it title? Is it registration? Are they exempt? This is all very esoteric, even for practitioners. And a lot of times MDs will say, well, gee, I should only offer a referral to somebody who's licensed. But again, it's very, very confusing for them. And this can raise a lot of unresolved public policy debates. For example, who's a real naturopath? What's a naturopath versus a naturopathic doctor, or a naturopathic doctor versus a naturopathic physician? And there are passionate debates about these terms. What does the public understand? What does the public expect? How might patients be misled, or how might they be injured if they misunderstand the training and competence of the person they're seeing and the claims that that person is making? For example, Dr. Garcia alluded to the primary care provider issue. Should naturopathic doctors achieve licensure across all states? This was a question, kind of a trick question posed to me by the White House Commission on Complementary Alternative Medicine, because depending on, it's a yes-no question. I don't like yes-no questions because you immediately alienate half the room and there's a black and white yes or no. But of course, they didn't like you know, there are a number of things that we need to think about. When should NDs refer to MDs, and should MDs ever have to refer back to NDs? Big questions. I hear resounding yeses, so have the applause meter. I mentioned the new statutes, relatively new, granting licensure the ability for unlicensed providers to practice without a license. This is actually kind of licensure, because licensure is just permission from the state to do something, but it's not called licensure, it's called permission for unlicensed providers, another sort of epistemological, conceptual blink in the map. But basically, they can lawfully practice so long as they don't make a medical diagnosis and treatment. What's that? How does it differ from a regular diagnosis and treatment? I thought all diagnosis and treatment constituted the practice of medicine. At least it does according to the statute, so this is changing. As long as they do not dissuade the patient from necessary medical care. They tell patients about their theory, their level of training, and how they practice, and they meet other disclosure requirements. And this statute, which only people with good eyesight can read, talks about, it basically defines unlicensed healthcare practices, and I would call this the smorgasbord approach. For example, acupressure. Somebody who's not licensed can offer acupressure, but not acupuncture. Alexander technique, aromatherapy, Ayurveda, cranial sacral, crystal therapy, detoxification, energy healing, Rolfing, Gerson therapy, therapeutic touch, herbology, or herbalism, polarity therapy, homeopathy, non-diagnostic iridology. I'm not sure what that is. Bodywork, Reiki, mind-body healing practices, naturopathy, and Qigong energy healing. Interesting, naturopathy is listed. So in Florida, Minnesota, and Rhode Island, you can offer any of these practices without any kind of licensure as long as you make some disclosure and follow the other rules. Now, it's important to look at the exclusion. Obviously, things like surgery are not allowed, X-ray radiation, prescribing. What about talking about dietary supplements? Is that prescribing? Practices that invade the body by puncture of the skin, et cetera, or practices that are defined elsewhere. And the restrictions include posting a notice that the state has not adopted any educational and training standards for unlicensed healthcare practitioners. So we're really going back to colonial times when anybody could set up a practice, and caveat emptor is the rule. And when Dr. Garcia spoke about beneficence, non-maleficence, and autonomy, this follows a philosophy of autonomy, places a high value on people having choice. It puts the non-maleficence value sort of in the background, and there are people who are passionately committed to this perspective. However, it should be noted that non-licensed practitioners are still vulnerable to claims that they've exceeded their competence and have thereby crossed the line into unlicensed medical practice. If courts continue the historical tendency to define diagnosis and treatment very broadly, which is where the statutes began, they could basically potentially eviscerate these statutory protections for unlicensed healers and then just go back to the way things were. And such laws also allow providers to be prosecuted if they commit fraudulent acts. What is fraud? How are you going to define it? How might it be viewed if somebody gets in trouble? They're engaging in contact that is reasonably interpreted by a client as engaging in sexual exploitation, or they're shown to engage in unlicensed healthcare practices that have safety issues. Here's California statute, which is a lot of fine print that you can review if you move to California. Okay, so that's licensure. Now, basically, licensure subsumes scope of practice, and the idea was that if all healing was diagnosis and treatment, then we had to carve something else out for everybody else. So what the law did is it said, well, medical doctors have unlimited scope of practice, but for other professionals, we're going to create a limited scope of practice, hopefully defined in a statute, and then people, practitioners, have to work within the scope of competence, which is their scope of practice. And there are a lot of scope of practice boundaries that are undefined, not just in this profession, but in many other professions. For example, what about acupuncturists and herbs? You would think that every acupuncturist should be able to include herbal medicine as part of their practice, but not so in all states or in all institutions. What about massage therapy and mental health care counseling? What about the boundary there when people come not just for relaxation, but there's some very energetic body work going on? How does that fit in? Or what about chiropractors and colonic irrigation? Is that part of chiropractic? Now, the issue is that licensed providers who exceed their scope of practice can be considered to be practicing medicine. Because of that very broad definition of medicine, if you're outside of your scope of practice, a prosecutor could say, well, you've crossed the line into this unlimited domain where you're diagnosing and treating disease, and that's medicine. So this can raise questions. For example, can a chiropractor, let's say in Washington State, recommend B vitamins, something as simple as B vitamins, to a patient for stress reduction? And you might say, why not? That's part of chiropractic. And here's a case from 1981 where the court said chiropractors can give dietary advice, but mere advice is a very different matter than prescribing vitamins. Is that an oxymoron? I wonder. But they said this was prescription to treat disease, which is unlicensed medical practice. So that chiropractor was basically prosecuted successfully. And this is very familiar from conventional medicine, this litigation between orthopedic surgeons and podiatrists as to whether the ankle was part of the foot. And here is a case, People versus Benno, where a chiropractor examined a patient's elbow, and the court said, well, the elbow is so disconnected from the spine that this is far outside chiropractic scope of practice. And interestingly, this case went up to the appellate court, and the appellate court reversed and said, well, you know, it's one body, the toe bone's connected to the... And then it went up on appeal, and the Michigan Supreme Court said no. It's preposterous to think that these different pieces are connected. In some audiences, that doesn't get a laugh. So since the 1880s, the law has defined medicine broadly as synonymous with all healing. And this is really part of the leitmotif of my first book, which is I try to say healing is a very broad universe. Medicine is part of it, and we have to look at things perhaps in new ways. And the law assigns unlimited licensure to MDs and limited licensure to non-MDs, including NDs. So in that sense, there isn't a parity in that there's sort of a carve-out. Everybody else has something more limited. However, you know, scope of practice also, the downside is that it carves patients into parts, and it assigns different parts of the patient to different specialties. So the chiropractors get the spine, the mental health counselors get the brain or the emotions. Well, I don't know if those are in the brain. Maybe they're somewhere else. Massage therapists get the muscles. But nobody really gets the whole thing except conventional medical doctors. So I thought I would take that and just move a little bit into the legal definition of naturopathic medicine. In my profession, some of us consider anal to be a compliment. So I'll get into the definition. So naturopathic medicine means the discipline that includes physiotherapy, natural healing processes, and minor surgery, and has its objective of maintaining the body and or restoring it to a normal state of health. How many people knew that by heart before walking into the room? Okay, nobody raised their hand. So I look at this sort of with Sherlock Holmes magnifying glass, and I say, well, what's expressly included, or what's implied, or expressly not prohibited, which is kind of like expressly included, sort of a double negative. What's expressly excluded, and what's left open? And you'll see that a lot is left open, either for the board after today, or for interpretation by the courts, which is not that good, because that involves somebody who gets into trouble, and then the court has to make a decision. I guess the subtext there would be, in response to Dr. Garcia's challenge, that it's probably a healthy thing for the profession to try to iron these things out if you believe that you can be proactive and try to help guide the future rather than wait for a verdict that then everybody has to respond reactively to. So we just talked about what's expressly included. You just look at the plain meaning of the statute. Courts are big on plain meaning, if meanings are ever plain. And it's the discipline that includes physiotherapy, natural healing processes, and minor surgery. And some of those terms, such as minor surgery, are defined. It has as its objective the maintaining of the body or restoring it to a normal state of health. Now, that is very, very, very broad. And if you just take that at its face value, it seems to include quite a bit. Now then it goes on to say, nothing in this chapter shall be construed to, meaning this is expressly not prohibited, meaning it's allowed. So Christian Science, person who by religious or spiritual means, is there a difference between religious and spiritual means? There's actually an exception to the medical licensing statutes that talks about religious care, but it has to be religion within the tenets of an organized church. So this is actually a little bit different than that. Keep reading. To prevent or cure disease or suffering in accord with the tenets of any church. There it is. So it has to be in a church. What's a church? I don't know. That's beyond the scope of this room. That's getting big question. Anesthetics or antiseptics, ordering diagnostic tests, etc. Okay, nothing shall be construed to, now this is expressly excluded, nothing shall be construed to authorize licensees to practice optometry or administer chiropractic adjustments or any system or method of treatment not authorized in this chapter. Now what does that mean? If you read that literally, it sounds like, well, if it's not written in the statute, you can't do it. So which language is going to be the most important and controlling language? This is just kind of a puzzle. I'm not going to answer it in the Q&A. You can't write prescriptions or dispense drugs. We have to look to the definition of drugs or do major surgery, except the naturopathic physicians are not prohibited from recommending specific and appropriate over-the-counter pharmaceuticals. And there's some other language there. Okay. Drugs means, and everybody should probably will want to read this on their own after class, after talks. And most of you you're probably all familiar, more familiar with this than I am, the formulary, homeopathic substances recognized in the pharmacopoeia, etc. Okay, nothing shall be construed to authorize the administration or of any substance by penetration of the skin, except for administering vitamins and minerals. Childbirth regulated separately. Okay. So after reading all of the fine print, do we get some help on the lights? I see some people straining. Anne, did we get some help on the lights at all? Okay. Godot will come. So if you're asking, is X within my licensure, things like colonic irrigation or craniosacral therapy, or mental health counseling, or therapeutic touch, or, and we could probably add a dozen other things on this list that you know about, but I don't. So is it within my licensure? Again, this is not a yes-no question, so as a lawyer, I would go back to some of that language, or perhaps if the board wants to look at the regs that it has in place and think about how it might amend them, we can go back and look at some of that language. Now this problem actually, again, arises a lot for MDs. What about EDTA? Chelation therapy, intravenous, hydrogen peroxide, nutritional and dietary approaches. So a lot of MDs have found themselves getting into trouble because this is the gray zone where it's not expressly included, it's not expressly excluded, you've got some language, but nothing's really responsive. So people do it and they take a chance and then they find themselves under investigation. Now it's not really a scope of practice issue given that they have, quote, unlimited licensure. But it is a disciplinary issue, which we'll talk about in the second part. Now, I haven't really found any ND cases to showcase to you today, and my guess is there probably are very few out there, or maybe there are few out there yet, or for some, whatever reason we just don't have the information. Or perhaps people haven't really been enforcing very strictly against these issues, or maybe they're overwhelmed and not sure where to go next. But again, I just highlight the two sections from the statute that I looked at, and I ask, do any of these modalities, are we going to interpret the statute again so broadly that if it's not expressly excluded, it's allowed? Or are we going to look at the part of the statute that says, if it's not a method of treatment that's allowed, it's prohibited? How are you going to read that statute? And so the first cut when you're in practice is obviously your own judgment call. You're going to make a guess, an educated guess. And you might ask, for example, how prevalent is this therapy within the profession? Am I an outlier? If there's an expert defined before the board, am I going to be perceived as an outlier? As a second cut, an attorney can look at language, which is what I've just done, and can give you a reading. You can also consult your state regulatory board. They may not have the answer. Your state professional association, they may or may not have the answer. They might be more or less conservative than you are. You can ask the state attorney general for an opinion. You can try to assess your own risk level. But beware the twin risks of discipline for exceeding the scope of practice and criminal prosecution for unlicensed practice of medicine. Now, this is sort of the fear part of the talk, those two bullets. So, but just to be aware that that's a real grounded possibility that we have to be aware of. And the chiropractic court cases have taken a very conservative view. I mentioned colonic irrigation. A number of courts have said, well, this is not in chiropractic scope of practice because it's not expressly included in the statute. And the chiropractic statute has a very ambiguous broad definition. Similar to the one we looked at for naturopathic medicine, it basically deals with adjusting the spine and manipulating so that nerve energy can flow freely. So courts have said, well, colonic irrigation has nothing to do with the flow of nerve energy, ergo, it's unlicensed medical practice. And the same conclusion has come up with respect to iridology and also acupuncture, because it was the penetration of the skin. And therefore, they said, well, this is medicine, this is surgery. And I mentioned the case about examining the elbow. Okay, that concludes scope of practice. We can come back to that in the panel. I'm going to now move to a new topic, which is malpractice. So malpractice consists of two elements. One is violating the standard of care, and the second is that it injures a patient. And both elements are necessary. So there's no malpractice if you follow the standard of care, and there's no malpractice if there's no injury. However, in cases of ambiguity, juries are likely to say, particularly if there's an MD involved, well, it was the alternative medicine that caused the injury. And it might be difficult to approve or to assess causation, and that might be sort of a conclusion. Or they might say that the provider neglected conventional standard of care, and therefore that caused indirect harm, or that they delivered a harmful therapy and that caused direct harm. So you'll see these terms, indirect, direct harm. I'm just mentioning them so you know what they are. Okay, another totally separate theory of malpractice is informed consent. It's too bad you can't see the slides. Is there anything you can do from the back? I'm sorry to keep interrupting with this, but I see. To do what? Okay. Can we get two strong volunteers to move the projector? The screen. I'm sorry, but I have so much information on the slides that I want you to be able to take advantage of it. And I also have some cartoons toward the end. Does anybody know how many, while people are working on this. How many chiropractors it takes to change a light bulb?
One.
Why? Dubai, it takes 25 visits, that's right. One chiropractor, 25 visits, right? I hope that joke will be edited off the DVD version. You never know who's watching. Thank you very much. That's how many does it take to change a light bulb? Just one, but the light bulb really has to want to change. It's actually how many psychiatrists does it take? Okay, so informed consent is the duty to disclose and discuss all material treatment alternatives with and their potential risks and benefits with patients. This comes out, of course, out of medicine. But you could apply it across to all professions, as Dr. Garcia suggested. So, for example, if an ND passionately believes in natural healing, but surgery is really necessary and indicated, and the ND fails to disclose the possibility of surgery, well, one could reasonably say that this is a failure of informed consent and hence malpractice, and if the patient, of course, is injured. Now, we could take the example for medicine. We could say, well, what about, let's have total parity here. You know, what about a medical doctor who fails to recommend something useful, even though it's alternative? Well, you know, we could apply that same standard. I've actually written about this and argued that why not? We should apply informed consent across the board, and everything works both ways. However, the treatment has to be reasonable and feasible. That's probably going to be judged by current medical evidence. And there's actually one case where a patient claimed that she should have been informed of the possibility of chelation therapy instead of having bypass surgery. And what the court said was very interesting. It said that would be a fine argument, and it would succeed if the medical evidence was there. But the evidence isn't there just yet, therefore no claim for informed consent. But that's a powerful precedent. Now, the third theory of malpractice is failure of the duty to refer. This is typically a failure of the non-MD to refer to an MD, where the patient's condition is outside the provider's education, training, and skill. So, for example, the chiropractor who purports to cure diabetes through chiropractic and fails to refer the patient to an MD. But you might also think about an ND who fails to, who tries to treat cancer rather than offering supportive care in conjunction with an oncologist. Now, you can debate these specific examples and say, well, I agree, I disagree. There's some nuances that you haven't taken into consideration in my clinical practice. You know, X has come up. Could you please tell me, is this ethical? Is it unethical? Is it legal? Is it illegal? I'm going to refer you back to the first slide with the fine print with a disclaimer just to say, you know, these things are really assessed in hindsight by juries in a malpractice case. That's why it's good to become educated and see the potential risk areas ahead of time, because that's what lawyers do. And ethicists, they point out areas of risk and possibility. So hindsight is always 20/20. Now, standards of care are specific to profession, medicine, physical therapy, nursing. They all have their own standards and typically are proven by an expert who testifies at trial. Well, how do we define the standard of care for integrative medicine? Is there an integrative medicine standard of care? And a lot of courts would say no, there's just a standard of care applicable to the profession. This is a new idea and we're not going to adopt it, and you just have to follow the conventional standard. Make sure the conventional bases are covered. If they're not and somebody's injured, the jury can find a verdict for malpractice. This trial's an outrage, Your Honor. My client is entitled to a jury of pairs. So, we don't want to confuse apple and oranges. We're going to judge pairs by a jury of pairs and not have a new standard. So cases involving MD suggest that the clinician has no different duty in integrative medicine than in conventional care, that they must at least satisfy conventional diagnosis and make sure the necessary conventional bases are covered. So you can't exclude alternative care in favor of alternative care if the alternative care is going to be ineffective or if conventional care is necessary. Here's a case, Sherrell versus Gonzalez. The MD treated the patient with nutritional protocol. She had cancer. He also used hair analysis for diagnosis. And the jury found that he was negligent. The patient didn't improve. In fact, she got worse and she died. And the court said no practitioner of alternative medicine could prevail in a malpractice case, as the term non-conventional may well necessitate a finding that the doctor who practices such medicine deviates from accepted medical standards. So in this quote, the court basically equated non-conventional alternative with below the standard of care. It's just a simple mathematical formula. And what this did is it created what I call malpractice per se, meaning if you're an MD, you can't practice alternative medicine because by default, you've committed malpractice. So what I did is I've suggested that this isn't really the best way to go, and you want to actually look for injury, and you want to refine this notion of standard of care a little bit more. And I've done some writing about that. Now, this is just one court in New York, but it's kind of a snapshot, and it shows the way that things can sometimes go when you get before a judge and a jury. It also happened in this case that because the MD was selling supplements and making a profit, that the jury could reasonably conclude that he was greedy and reckless instead of just negligent. So punitive damages were allowed in this case. Here's another case where an MD recommended ozone treatment, administered hydrogen peroxide intravenously, injected vitamin C near the patient's rectum, and treated an abscess with a charcoal poultice mixed in a coffee can. And the moral of the story is, don't do this at home. It also shows that a lot of times when you look for judicial opinions as precedent, some of the most egregious cases are the ones that you're going to see reported in the opinions. And that's why they say hard cases make bad law. You look to the law, you're going to find some very difficult cases, and that's going to be what's shaping and influencing legal thinking. Now, back in 1998, somebody did a study of malpractice claims against CAM providers, and the purpose of this was really to realistically assess whether there was any greater negligence in alternative medicine as opposed to regular medicine. If there was, then the message would be MDs should be very, very cautious. And if there wasn't, then they should be a bit more relaxed. So they looked at claims against chiropractors, and they found things such as excessive force, failing to take appropriate x-rays, continuing to treat after manipulation, after an adverse reaction to manipulation, misleading statements about qualifications, and again, big one, failure to refer to an MD when indicated. And against naturopaths, they found a misdiagnosis and prescription of amphetamines without a physical, acupuncturous infection of patients with Hep B and spontaneous pneumothorax, and negligent recommendation of fasting. There's actually a case, People versus Andrews, where an unlicensed healer recommended a fasting regimen and the patient got worse, and I think ultimately died. And the defense was, well, I was just practicing religion. It was a religious fast. And the court said, no, you diagnosed and you treated. You were practicing medicine, therefore prosecution. Here's a recent case. Chiropractor's patient came in, a chiropractor, for plantar fasciitis in his right heel. Chiropractor fastened a hot pack to the heel, closed the door. He left the room for 12 to 15 minutes. Might have gone to Starbucks. Plaintiff said, you're burning the hell out of my foot. And so the chiropractor applied burn cream, but it was too late. And the plaintiff needed a skin graft, and the court said that a reasonably prudent chiropractor would not have left the room for 12 to 15 minutes. This is a question from Dr. Garcia. So suppose that the best medical practice, or what you think is the best medical practice, is to treat the patient with a prescription that is not within the MD formulary. For example, use of thiazide diuretics, did I pronounce that correctly? In treating hypertension, or use of common antibiotics other than Cipro for treating urinary tract infections, how should MDs respond to lack of clear authority to follow best practice particularly in the absence of any direct guidance from the statute of board regulations. Now, I think Dr. Garcia invited me hoping that I could answer these questions for you and give you a clear, straightforward, unambiguous yes or no that you could take home in the last slide, but I'm not going to be able to because I think these are really, really outstanding, very challenging questions that need to be answered not by me, but by everybody in this room, by the whole entire profession, by the AANP and the other associations and the new board members going forward. These are questions to be wrestled with over the next couple of years and wrestled with individually as well as you're on the front lines. I just alienated those of you that wanted the yes or no answer. But just to give you some approaches to this, a framework, which is what I would like to, am able to do, if you recall the licensing statute, NDs can't prescribe drugs, and the definition except certain items such as those within a formulary. So if you're outside of the formulary or you're outside of what's in the statute, a good argument could be made by the board in a disciplinary action, that you could be exceeding your scope of practice. And this could also potentially be considered unlicensed medical practice since you've gone beyond your scope of practice. So you've got the issue of discipline, you've got potential malpractice liability, you've got potential criminal prosecution for the unlawful practice of medicine. So I think I just got that half of the room back. Probably lost the other half now that's probably going, oh my God, I thought the answer was okay. All right. What about another one of Dr. Garcia's conundrums? Refusal to recommend antibiotics for recurrent child ear infections based on honoring tole causum. Did I pronounce that correctly? Okay. Let nature heal and avoiding symptom suppression. Or refusal to prescribe antibiotics, let's say again for urinary tract infection, based on a concern or philosophy that to do so would be suppressive. Instead, the ND proposes constitutional treatments including hydrotherapy, steam veggies, minimal grains, biotherapeutic drainage, and allergy testing. So would this be outside the scope of practice? How many would say yes, just to get a consensus? How many would say no? How many are not sure? Okay, the brave few of you kind of put up your hands. So nobody said yes, quite a few said no, and a handful said not sure. Okay, the question is, would somebody be, there's no scope of practice issue because, again, it's not recommending something beyond the scope of practice. It's refusing or refraining from doing something. So the issues would be discipline and liability. Question mark. Now, this is the framework that I developed with a colleague, some colleagues, to guide medical doctors who were asked a similar question in their profession, which is, when can I recommend CAM to my patients? Instead of the black and white, yes or no, never, it's unethical, no, it's untested, yes, it's completely proven. We said, let's divide the world into four regions. So you can see in the A region, we said, look at where the evidence supports safety and efficacy, good evidence for safety and efficacy. We said if the therapy falls within this region, and you could translate this across professions, then recommend, continue to monitor the patient, but this is a good therapy. You're probably not going to have a malpractice issue because by definition, safe and effective. And the examples we gave were chiropractic for acute low back pain, acupuncture for chemotherapy-induced nausea and dental pain, and mind-body techniques for chronic pain and insomnia. So we put some therapies in the A box. Opposite, you can see the D box. Evidence indicates either serious risk or inefficacy. So obviously here, the therapeutic posture is to avoid and discourage. Probably going to have liability by definition, not safe, not effective, you're probably going to have liability. So we put it in this box, and again, people can agree or disagree with the specifics, and some of these might change over time. The evidence might shift. We might move from one box into another. But we said injections of unapproved substances, toxic herbs, dangerous delay or replacement of curative conventional treatments, or inattention to known herb-drug interactions, such as St. John's wort and indinavir or cyclosporin. Now, most therapies, or at least a good deal of them, are going to fall in B and C, where either the evidence regarding safety is inconclusive or the evidence regarding efficacy is inconclusive. And we said you're slightly better in the C box. You're slightly better in the B box, where the evidence supports safety. Even if you're not sure about efficacy, at least you're not going to injure somebody, as long as you cover the conventional bases. And we said you can allow or accept these therapies, caution the patient, and closely monitor for effectiveness. And you can see examples such as acupuncture for chronic pain, mind-body techniques for metastatic cancer, and self-hypnosis. And we said where the evidence supports efficacy, but you're not sure about safety, watch for safety, monitor, probably okay to allow these therapies. And we included St. John's Wort for depression, saw palmetto for BPH, chondroitin sulfate for osteoarthritis, ginkgo biloba for cognitive function dementia, acupuncture for breech presentation. So a lot of dietary supplements are going to fall in this box. And we say you could be liable, but monitor. It's probably going to be okay, but watch the safety. Now, moving on from that framework to defenses, suppose that there is a malpractice lawsuit. You need a defense. Here's one defense. Again, used mostly in the MD context, assumption of risk. The plaintiff sought a non-surgical treatment for breast cancer. She signed a detailed consent form releasing Dr. Emmanuel Ricci from liability. The tumor spread. The jury found him liable for malpractice. Thank you so much. You are such wonderful healers, you could read that. I'm losing my voice. The jury found for malpractice, but it had the award and it said that the patient was 50% comparatively negligent. She'd also signed a form assuming the risk. I'm sorry. The appellate court reversed and said she had signed a form. She had expressly assumed the risk of injury, and that was a complete defense. So basically what this does is it gives MDs an opportunity to let patients opt for an alternative therapy and sign a release. And a lot of people say, well, can you draft a good release for me? And the answer has to be, I can draft a release. However, not all states follow Schneider. And the doctrine obviously doesn't authorize negligence. It's a bit circular. You get sued for negligence, but you have a defense, the patient signed a form. But you can't really be negligent, otherwise the form doesn't work. It just provides support or a defense where you've taken a reasonable therapeutic route. You have some evidentiary support, but for whatever reason it doesn't work, and the patient has authorized this. That'll be 589. Please sign this medical release. So we don't want to go overboard. So when I presented this framework to MDs, I tried to offer some general liability management strategies. First, to determine the clinical risk level and use that framework and decide whether to recommend, avoid, and discourage, or allow that therapy while monitoring conventionally. Provide adequate informed consent, communicate effectively, and document the therapeutic choice and keep a backup file of the literature. Now, if you're interested in some of the detail, I'll give you my websites at the end and some of the articles. You can find links to most of the articles and books that will provide all of the information that you need. So do these strategies translate? By and large, they do. Should MDs have less or more leeway than MDs? Who decides? Who should decide? Again, remember that it's the profession that sets its own standards. And this is evolving over time. And remember that discipline is a different issue than malpractice, discipline being decided by the board, malpractice by juries and judges based on experts within the profession. And judicial decisions can create cautions and also set practice parameters. Also remember Russell's rule of risk. After Russell, a famous mathematician, the probability of malpractice is precisely equal to the physician's arrogance, real or perceived, divided by the physician's competence. And this has been shown valid in many statistical trials.
You need a sec?
Okay, now another issue that arises in malpractice is that of referrals, and this is really critical for integrative medicine to succeed. You know, can your MD refer to you an ND? Can your MD refer to a chiropractor, an acupuncturist safely, comfortably, and truly make the practice collaborative and integrative? Now, as we mentioned, there is a duty to refer, a legal and ethical duty to refer from an ND, chiropractor, LAC, MT, etc., to an MD. But there's no duty back from an MD to an ND. No legal and ethical duty currently. Should there be? Perhaps. I've argued yes. I've written about this. There's also an MD concern about liability for referring to a CAM provider who turns out to be negligent. Let's say an orthopedic surgeon sends a patient to a chiropractor. Chiropractor's negligent. Is the orthopedic surgeon going to get sued for the referral? Or a family medicine doctor to an acupuncturist, or a pediatrician to an ND. So you really want to resolve this question in the minds of the MDs to make them able to refer and practice integratively. Now, the same study of claims that I referred to earlier noticed that in medicine, claims per 100, policyholders 9 in medicine, 6.2 in primary care compared to 2.6 in chiropractic and 0.2 in massage. So the moral of the story was CAM providers don't get sued as much. They didn't study claims against NDs. And the article that came out in JAMA hypothesized that there were lower claims because CAM tends to be less physically invasive, injuries tend to be less physically severe, and people tend not to sue their CAM providers because they have lower claims consciousness, which is a bit of an oxymoron. I don't normally put consciousness in the same sentence as claims, but so be it. Bob ate these and got sick. Let's leave him alone. I say we eat him and then we sue somebody for making us sick. So we worry about rising claim consciousness in society. The general rule is that an MD is not liable for referring somebody to a specialist. And the argument in this article was, well, let's just apply that same rule across to referrals to CAM providers. However, we lawyers have something called the exception that swallows the rule. Here we have three exceptions swallowing a rule. The referral delayed or deferred necessary medical treatment. The referring provider knew or should have known they were referring to somebody who was incompetent. The person they referred to is the physician's agent, either because state law requires supervision or an extended consultation, or there is joint treatment. Now, joint treatment doesn't mean treating the joints. It means that people have treated together and that there's enough of a collaborative relationship between them that negligence of one is going to be imputed to the other. But let's look at, go back to the first one. Let's say that an MD referred to an ND for routine care and the ND refused to prescribe an antibiotic for repeated ear infections. Could somebody say that this delayed or deferred conventional treatment or that the referred to provider was incompetent? And I'm just kind of making these examples up and just hypothesizing, you know, what's the jury going to say down the line? And so the conclusion would be that an MD could be concerned about referral liability with regard to an ND whose practices could conceivably be problematic as later viewed by a jury if the patient is injured. So this is something to bear in mind as we move forward. Now, from the MD perspective, there's sort of a legal catch-22 between these different theories, because if the MD keeps the CAM provider at arm's length and holds them very distant, and they don't know anything. Oh, I don't want to know who I'm referring to. I'm just sending you off so that I don't get sued. Well, then a court could say, well, you've made a negligent referral, or you've referred to somebody incompetent, and you should have known. On the other hand, if they work very closely and collaboratively, court could say, well, that's joint treatment. So you're liable on that ground. So there's a catch-22 between these different theories. And also, you know, what about the patient's perspective? Perhaps it's beneficial to the patient to have a close relationship because then you can truly collaborate and share information and share clinical insights. So perhaps you would have less liability by keeping them as arm's length, but you might have a greater chance of patient injury. So basically what I've concluded from these slides is we truly need an integrative approach, because the more you know, the more you're protected against potential harm, which ultimately is going to be the thing that leads to malpractice. Just a word here about institutional liability. Basically, institutions can be directly negligent if they hire people and the institution has itself failed its standard of care. For example, failure of credentialing or faulty equipment, hiring an incompetent nurse or acupuncturist. But they can also be vicariously liable for the negligence of an employee or agent. Classic example of a patient who developed gangrene in a hospital emergency room, and the hospital was vicariously liable for the negligence of its operating room staff. So the idea would be that the institution could potentially be liable both under direct and vicarious liability, so it's going to want to be very careful in hiring providers. Okay, where we are is I've given you an overview of some of the legal and ethical issues in integrative medicine. I've talked extensively about licensure. We looked at some hot buttons in naturopathic scope of practice. We talked about malpractice liability, who sets the standard of care, what's the standard of care in integrative medicine, and a little bit about liability risk management. After the break, I'm going to talk about discipline, spiritual care, a little bit more in depth on ethics, and then some future directions for the field. So look forward to seeing you after the break, which is about 15 minutes. Thank you. Welcome back. Okay, the cartoon shows hot dog, soda, ice cream. Other stand says, file a lawsuit against hot dog, soda, and ice cream manufacturers. Which one would you choose? Continuing with our theme, Dr. Garcia asked me to mention among the top reasons for discipline of an ND: practice outside the scope of practice, sexual impropriety between NDs and patients, and failure to treat in a manner that minimizes harm to patient. Let's take a look at all of these. What is sleep? Well, how can you know sleep when you're awake? The answer is to go to sleep and find out what it is. But I cannot know it in this way. This question must be raised in sleep. But I cannot raise the question then. So that is sleep. So we don't want to fall asleep. We want to be wide awake in the best sense. So as mentioned, licensed professions usually have their own regulatory boards, such as the Board of Chiropractic or the OBNE. Sometimes, for example, acupuncturists will be regulated by the medical board, and the board has the power to discipline or sanction its providers for professional misconduct, also known as unprofessional conduct. Unprofessional conduct includes such acts as obtaining the license fraudulently, practicing with gross negligence, practicing while impaired by alcohol or drugs. And finally, this is one from the medical licensing laws, any departure from prevailing and acceptable medical standards. It's interesting to think by analogy as to what's happening across professions. What does that curious phrase mean? What is the plain meaning? Could CAM be perceived as a departure from prevailing and acceptable medical standards, and thus ground for professional discipline irrespective of any evidence of wrongdoing or patient harm? This is the problem that MDs have been wrestling with as they venture into integrative medicine, and it's good to be aware of it. Henry Guess was a case in North Carolina in 1990. Guess was a licensed family doc who used homeopathic medicine for his patients when conventional medicine failed. The state board charged him with unprofessional conduct, alleging a departure from standards of prevailing and acceptable medical practice in North Carolina. Indeed, he had departed from acceptable medical standards in North Carolina because he was the only homeopath in the state, the only MD practicing homeopathy. So by definition, he was different. At the medical board hearing, there was no evidence of any injury to a single patient. In fact, some of them came and testified that he'd helped them. However, the medical board took away his license, and they agreed to reinstate it, provided that he renounced homeopathy. Chilling. The Superior Court reversed, finding the decision arbitrary and capricious. It went up to the State Supreme Court, which again reversed, reinstated the lower court, which had upheld the medical board decision. Basically, Guest lost his license and that stood. And the reasoning of the Supreme Court was that the plain meaning of the statute was broad enough to support the board. Any departure from prevailing standards meant any departure, period. No need to show patient harm. So Guest lost his license and he moved to another state. And subsequently, the voters came back and said the state medical board shall not anymore revoke the license of or deny a license to a person solely because that person is practicing alternative medicine, basically, unless the board can establish by competent evidence that the treatment, the alternative treatment, has a safety risk greater than the prevailing treatment, or that the treatment is generally not effective. If it's unsafe or ineffective, then licensure revocation. And other states have followed suit in enacting similar, quote, medical freedom legislation. Note that the medical freedom is that of the physician homeopath, or any MD, who practices alternative medicine, and that freedom translates down to the patient. There are also state medical boards with their own CAM regulations. Texas has a particularly balanced set of rules. Kentucky actually divides the world into three types of therapies. Validated, if you're offering a validated therapy, it's fine. If the therapy is invalidated, then you could be disciplined. And therapies that are considered implausible are considered invalidated, meaning they haven't been proven ineffective or unsafe. They just don't make any sense. We don't understand them. Therefore, invalidated. And then there's non-validated, but plausible and not yet proven. Now, who decides what's plausible? Texas says a physician MD may not be found guilty of unprofessional conduct on the basis of providing a complementary or integrative therapy, very modern language, unless the therapy has a safety risk for the patient that is unreasonably greater than the conventional treatment, unreasonably greater. Here's an example from Ontario, just showing you that this idea has spread across the border and is now being adopted elsewhere. Now, the Federation of State Medical Boards has model guidelines for use of CAM in medical practice. It says that a licensed physician will not be found guilty of unprofessional conduct for failure to practice medicine solely on the basis of using CAM. Now, the ND situation is very different. However, the Federation guidelines offer a strategy for therapies that may be at the borderland of what's acceptable in terms of known efficacy and safety. And it says that the medical record should document what's been discussed, risks and benefits, and any interference with conventional medicine. The treatment should also have a favorable risk-benefit ratio compared to conventional treatments, reasonably result in a positive outcome, and achieve a better effect than placebo. These are all conditions for physicians in the model guidelines to provide alternative therapies. So you might ask yourself, by analogy, which of the ND practices that you use would satisfy these criteria,
which would be acceptable to medical colleagues who may be bound by similar rules? How, if at all, should the criteria be revised for naturopathic medicine? Let's take a look again at Oregon's naturopathic regulation from the statutes. These are some disciplinary provisions. And there's a laundry list here. Thank you. I'm a firm believer in hydration. So some of these are obvious. Impersonating another physician would be a no-no, conviction of a crime. But what about number 8, negligence related to the practice of naturopathic medicine? So this really includes our top reasons listed earlier. So if there's negligence, going back to the portion of the first talk about malpractice, you could also be disciplined. So the issues of malpractice, scope of practice, and crossing boundaries all come into play. It follows that gross or repeated malpractice is really serious. And representing to a patient that a manifestly incurable condition or of sickness can be permanently cured is a problem. Again, a crossover with malpractice, and it recalls the duty to refer in serious cases, duty to refer for malpractice. Also, willful and consistent utilization of any naturopathic service or treatment that is contrary to recognized standards in the profession. So who sets standards in the profession? The profession, right? Who's buried in Grant's tomb? Okay. So willful and consistent utilization of any treatment contrary to standards set by the profession is a disciplinary issue. This is also very broad language, similar to the language in Guess. Any conduct or practice contrary to a recognized standard of ethics in the profession. So again, echoing what Dr. Garcia had argued, it benefits the profession to clarify its standards of ethics so that there's less ambiguity for practitioners, so people can be clear about the boundaries that they shouldn't be crossing. Any conduct or practice that does or might constitute a danger to the health or safety of a patient or the public. How might this be applied retrospectively? Any conduct, practice, or condition that does or might impair a physician's ability safely and skillfully to practice naturopathic medicine. Again, it's very, very broad, and everything that we've talked about potentially comes into play into these provisions. This is another challenge posed by Dr. Garcia. One of the naturopathic principles states the physician shall strive to identify and remove the causes of illness rather than to merely eliminate or suppress symptoms. Everybody's familiar with that. How does the belief in suppression play out in a licensed state where evidence of suppression is not universally recognized, perhaps not even within the profession? If an ND in Oregon believes antibiotics are suppressive to a patient's vital force, what are the ethical and/or legal consequences for the practitioner? Does the condition the patient have make a difference, say strep throat versus bladder infection? And you can spin out these different clinical scenarios and raise questions about this topic. And you might consider number 8, again, negligence, or 15, any conduct or practice contrary to the standards of the profession. And 22, which is very similar, treatment contrary to standards in the profession. Oh, jeepers, I've completely lost track here. What do you say I just randomly pull out some needles and we'll call it even? So for the people on the DVD, it's two porcupines practicing acupuncture. Picture's worth 1,000 words. So again, it's the profession that sets the standard of care and determines what's below the threshold and therefore negligent. And you can recall that liability grid where we had the four squares and try to use that to determine the relative safety and efficacy and the likelihood that a practice is going to be recognized as in the D box, an outlier, or in the B and C box, but heading toward the D box as things shift. And there's a convergence with the classical ethical values. of non-maleficence, the duty to do no harm, and beneficence, the duty to positively help a patient. Now let's turn to another topic, spiritual care. What about therapeutic touch, homeopathy, energetic medicine, Reiki, Bach flower, any hands-on treatment? This is a question again from Dr. Garcia for us to contemplate. Is evidence of safety, efficacy, or mechanism necessary to provide the therapy? How do practitioners maintain boundaries? And what about informed consent? And this is a very emerging area that very few people have thought about because it's so much in the realm of the unknown. Or maybe it's in the realm of the known for a lot of us, but it's in the realm of the formally unknown. In other words, we don't know a lot about how these things work, and there isn't a lot of good proof for the mainstream medical community to show that they do work. Would you priest get out of this way? What this girl needs a chiropractor. It's a deleted scene from the newly released version of The Exorcist. So it's important to honor our practice boundaries, whether we are hands-on healers or exorcists, or both. And the basic linear answer is that an ND can use spiritual care if it's within the scope of practice. This takes us back to, if it's not expressly excluded, it arguably has its objective of maintaining and restoring the body to a natural state. It may or may not be what people are trained in, but perhaps the board is going to set credentialing criteria, some standards, as it has for chelation therapy, or to require minimum number of hours or certain training. Maybe that would be useful. You could argue that it's unlikely to generate malpractice liability, of course, unless a patient was misled into relying on, say, prayer instead of getting the surgery that they needed to survive. But typically unlikely to harm somebody, but safety and efficacy would be relevant. And if no malpractice, unlikely to be a source of discipline. Let's talk a little bit about personal and professional boundaries as opposed to legal boundaries. This is really more in the province of the psychologist or psychiatrist, but I thought I would presume a little bit since it dovetails with the legal boundaries. And I called my first book Complementary and Alternative Medicine, Legal Boundaries and Regulatory Perspectives. The publisher wanted to call it Alternative Medicine and the Law, and the Law. I thought that was terribly boring. So I like my title better. But in any event, a boundary is a limit that separates a person from another and protects the individual's integrity, and there are different types of boundaries. Obviously, we all have a physical boundary, but we also have a sexual boundary, an emotional boundary, an intellectual boundary, and, for those that are sensitive, an energetic boundary. And what are these different boundaries, and how do we maintain awareness of them as we enter into spiritual care, which potentially has no boundaries or infinite boundaries? I was reading in the bookstore about multiple universes and how this is scientifically sustainable, that we could potentially just be, you know, one of many, many, many different universes. So Kalia Bristow is showing us the way ahead with her new client care manager, Modern Solicitors. This is British, need to new, see beyond. The billing hours realize that a client is a human being, not just a wallet. Wallet, client, now you try. So this is a lawyer being trained in the art of boundaries. And disciplinary issues often arise from boundary violations, which is why we are talking about them. And they're particularly, again, prevalent in spiritual care because of the unbounded zone. So, for example, a medical intuitive tells a patient, the reason you're going deaf is because you're not listening to God. Does this sound familiar? Has anybody heard this or maybe said it? I guess if you're the patient, you haven't heard it because you're not listening anyway. May be true on one level, but is it the appropriate level for you to tell your patient within your scope of practice, without more? For weeks, Nancy has been giving weekly acupuncture treatments to her patient, Ralph, for chronic neck pain. The treatments have been going very well. Both client and practitioner have been excited about the results. As they're saying goodbye, Nancy spontaneously gives Ralph a hug. Ralph tenses but says nothing to Nancy. The only touch to date has been limited to that necessary for placing needles in Ralph. So is this going to result in some kind of complaint to the Board of Acupuncture? Was it wise? Was it appropriate in the circumstances? And again, for Q&A, it's all appropriate under the circumstances. So I'm really just raising questions for you to discuss amongst yourselves and for continuing conversation. The practitioner asked the client who's on the table for a charitable donation for an organization with which the practitioner is involved. The practitioner solicits tax advice from a client who happens to be an accountant during an acupuncture treatment. Oh, by the way, during a session, the client talks about a politician who's a personal friend. The practitioner has wanted to meet the politician and asked for a personal introduction. So a state of vulnerability, whether you're on the table or in a chair or standing up or standing on your head in yoga class, often places the client in uncharted territory in which the client may not be aware of his or her own needs, options, or what constitutes appropriate boundaries and behavior. Therefore, it's especially appropriate for the healer to be aware of their boundaries and the client's confusion around boundaries. And the power differential between the healer and the client can lead to a breach of beneficence. And remember, the therapeutic alliance, that trust, which is so powerful to letting nature heal, and can create to maleficence, or the negative breach of trust as well. And according to Russell's rule of risk, the perceived arrogance divided by competence, a breach of trust can lead to injury, it can lead to malpractice, and to disciplinary investigation. So perception is everything, or is a lot of it. And there's been some research done to see why practitioners consciously or most unconsciously commit boundary violations. This goes in all professions, across healthcare professions, and other professions as well. I was going to say professional professions, but that would be redundant and repetitive. So, for example, the practitioner's disregard for the client, or caregiver burnout, or a practitioner's ignorance of the pitfalls, which is why I've been asked to address this today. Another really powerful one is underestimating the power of the energetic exchange, the power of the therapeutic alliance, the power of the trust placed in the healer. And of course, the practitioner's own unexamined personal baggage, and the practitioner's unacknowledged longing for love and spiritual connection. So trying to get one's needs met from the client. And this is actually very prevalent in spiritual communities. I've written a little bit about this in Future Medicine. I was delighted that Greg had read the book. And there's also a book written by an attorney, healer, a colleague of mine called Creating Right Relationships, a practical guide to ethics and energy therapies. And you can find both through my website if you'd like to pursue this further. Let's talk about informed consent, which is sort of the legal, ethical counterpart to the things we talked about. And we talked about it before with regular practice. So again, the obligation is to disclose reasonable and feasible options as judged by current evidence. But there may not be evidence for or against a specific energy therapy, so how do you describe it? And so boundary issues could arise moving from a very clinical perspective to suddenly moving into a very spiritual perspective. You suddenly shift the territory and the person may not be ready. And so the point is not to avoid energy work, but just to be aware that boundary issues, legal, ethical, and psychological, could arise, and they all work together. And informed consent could be difficult because risks and benefits could be unknown. So how do you tell somebody, what could happen one way or another? So even though I'm focusing on energy therapies, I think a lot of this relates to the discussion about the antibiotics and so on, things that really come from a philosophical perspective and may be supported by good evidence, may not be supported by good evidence, may have some mix of evidence and opinion, and it's extremely variable. More warning labels I'd like to see. Warning, eating 14 bags of Oreos a day can make you morbidly litigious. So truth in advertising, we want to be sure that our informed consent disclosure is appropriate to the situation. Let's talk a little bit more about ethics. You know, we spoke about the three fundamental values, the patient's autonomy interest, the clinician's duties to do no harm and to benefit the patient, and the state's interest in justice. And what will happen is that a lot of times these three will be in conflict. So you could argue that autonomy is the most fundamental value, to have the right to do what shall be done with your own body. But many clinicians think, no, non-maleficence is stronger. So if the patient wants it, but I think it's going to do some harm, I'm not going to allow it. I'm going to be extremely paternalistic. So there's that dance between autonomy, non-maleficence, paternalism. And historically, one or the other has dominated, and we seem to be in sort of a, you know, sine-cosine wave or a pendulum shift. So the clinician might say, I must do no harm, and it could be dangerous to rely on an untested CAM treatment when we have a perfectly good, safe, and effective conventional treatment. And the patient might say, but I want to try the CAM therapy, especially because it's natural. And where do you stand on the spectrum? And every audience is different, depends who's in the room. The Institute of Medicine came out with a very comprehensive document in 2005 called the Report on Complementary Alternative Medicine. I served as a consultant to that committee. And it said the goal should be the provision of comprehensive medical care that is based on the best scientific evidence available, that encourages patients to share in decision-making. There's the autonomy value, as is the third bullet, that promotes choices in care that can include CAM therapies when appropriate. Now, most of the members were part of the conservative, I would say, medical academic establishment. And so three is a very open and powerful bullet. However, everything works in balance. So we have scientific evidence as the top bullet. Dr. Adams at OSHU and I worked on this article. She was the lead author, where we tried to shift some of the language for ethical decision making. Because the literature at the time, a lot of articles would say, well, if it's untested, which is a huge conclusion because there are different degrees of evidence and different degrees of testing. If it's untested and all CAM therapies are untested, then it's unethical to provide it. And this was kind of a syllogism that people were using. So we said, wait a minute, let's take a look at these different factors. Let's look at the severity and acuteness of illness. If the illness is severe and acute, this militates more in favor of the conventional treatment. So does curability with conventional care. On the other hand, if the conventional treatment is invasive, toxic, and has a lot of side effects, you ought to think about the alternative treatment. The same if the quality of evidence of safety and efficacy for the CAM treatment is strong, the patient understands the risks and benefits of using a different route, willingly and voluntarily accepts those, and is very persistent in the intention to utilize the CAM treatment. So the slide is showing arrows going different ways to show you some of these factors go one way, some go another way. But basically, we've broken the world of either or, yes or no, ethical, unethical, black and white into. There are seven factors, and you should consider all of them, including, I would think, number three would be of interest to this audience, the invasiveness, toxicity, and side effects of conventional treatment. And this article was published in the Annals of Internal Medicine and has gone out to the conventional medical community. Working on the IOM report, actually incorporates this paradigm, and it also adds that there are not just three, but five ethical values to be held in balance in public policy considerations about integration of CAM therapies. The first is social commitment to public welfare. Is basically, does it look familiar? It's beneficence. And how about protecting patients from hazardous health practices? Is non-maleficence. And a respect for patient autonomy is familiar. But then it adds number four, which is very powerful, a recognition of medical pluralism. What is medical pluralism, and how do we recognize it? And how does this kind of take us back in the wheel to where we started 250 years ago? And public accountability. Now, there's a lot of science, there's a lot of data in the report, and then there's an ethics chapter. And the ethics chapter has its sort of stands on its own and contributes to the others. And also, terms like non-maleficence are interpreted from a pluralistic perspective. For example, respecting divergent cultural beliefs, creating an emotionally safe environment for CAM, and appreciating how CAM may fit into a patient's larger social, familial, or spiritual life. And allowing patients to make knowing and voluntary choices in healthcare in accord with their own values. So this is really a shift in consciousness. And look at medical pluralism, a moral commitment of openness to diverse interpretations of health and healing. And we distinguish pluralism from co-optation of CAM therapies by conventional medical practices. And we have a commitment to finding innovative ways to test therapies and assess efficacy beyond the RCT. And finally, suspending any categorical disbelief in CAM therapies. At the same time, we must be accountable to the public for prudent and fair use of healthcare resources, but we must also consider the vast array of perspectives that constitute the national and even international heritage of healing traditions. So how do we deal with Ayurvedic medicine? How do we deal with Tibetan pulse diagnosis? How do we deal with it from a perspective of evidence? And how do we deal with it from a perspective of ethics? This is the world that the IOM report sets out. Now, where do we go from here? Predicting is difficult, especially the future. And I want to thank Vice President Quayle for that quote. At least it's attributed to him. So go to jail for chiropractic. And also, chiropractic's first century or so will be remembered as the 100-year war. This is from 2001. You know, juxtaposing these implies that we haven't made much progress, and maybe we won't. As part of my work at Harvard, I did a study, a couple of different studies. One was of 19 centers to look at, integrative care centers, to look at their credentialing liability and dietary supplements policy, just to look at where are we going moving forward in integrative healthcare. How are integrative care centers how are they creating policies? How are they handling integrative medicine in terms of setting up the policies that are going to guide practitioners to avoid liability, institutional liability, scope of practice issues, and so on? And we followed that up with 39 academic medical centers. And we interviewed them, and we asked, do you offer alternative medicine? Here's what we say it is. Do you know what it is? Where do you offer it? And we found that they offered therapies in very, very diverse departments, from family medicine to neurology. And then finally, we interviewed 25 academic medical centers like Stanford and Georgetown and George Washington and Duke and Minnesota. And we interviewed their key personnel, and we asked them, what are the legal and social obstacles and institutional obstacles that you are encountering in implementing models of integrative care within your institution? See, before that, the debate had been regular versus irregular, conventional versus alternative. Now, the question is, if it's integrative, what is integrative? Does it work? Does it help people? What are the resistance barriers? And how do you overcome the resistance barriers? And what are you creating? What's new? One of the things we found is that the way that people put integrative care teams together is very, very unique depending on the institution. So among the 19 centers, this is just a chart showing how many mind-body therapists, how many chiropractors, and then how many naturopaths were included. You can see at the bottom that the naturopaths were kind of the last to be incorporated into the integrative care models. Now, this is data that has now been published from 2002. But we also found that nationwide, hospitals are significantly integrating alternative and conventional therapies, both through their designated clinical complementary medicine centers and through departments. And although they're tackling issues of credentialing, liability, and dietary supplement policies, they're doing so in a very individualized way. So you've seen one integrative care center, you've seen one integrative care center. They're all different. So the old paradigm, Your Honor, I request permission to put three little slits in this witness before I grill him. The witness is a hot dog for those of you that are from afar. The new paradigm, squeeze from the bottom and flatten as you go up. A toothpaste massage. In functional medicine and beyond complementary medicine, I talked about Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Maslow said that we move up from meeting our most basic needs, physiological, then we try to meet our safety needs, then we meet our need for love, then we meet our need for esteem, which is a kind of communal acceptance of love, and finally we move up to self-actualization. And the idea is that as we look at regulation, we want to look at the entire complex of human needs. We don't just want to look at the base. And so I said, let's draw an analogy. At the base, if we're dealing with our physiological needs, we're talking about regulating fraud. And if we move up to trying to feel safe, we're regulating quality assurance. And then as we move up to healthcare freedom, the idea of autonomy. And then we move up beyond that toward integration, which is encapsulated by some of the IOM report. And then finally, we move up to transformation. Because if you want to regulate healthcare, you want to do more than just make sure that all the bad people that are injuring people are weeded out. You want to make sure that healthcare really achieves health, wholeness, at all levels, from the base all the way up to the top. So we have to include not just the physical body, but also the intellectual, emotional, energetic, and then the self-actualization, which is transformation. So each level of the pyramid is important. You can't have your head in the clouds but not look at the ground. You can't look at the ground but not look up at the clouds. However, I argue that our regulation is focused entirely on fraud control, and we've devoted a lot of time to it, and it's extremely important, and it's clear that there's a lot more work to be done on that level. But in this part of the talk, which I've often given to medical MD audiences, I said Maslow argued that to focus on only the lowest level of human conduct and to ignore the possibility for the transcendental is not only neurotic, but also the mark of a sick society. So fraud control is epitomized by all the language and statutes and cases and regulations talking about quacks and fakers, resourceful entrepreneurs, and others who would take advantage of patients' vulnerability and inherently gullible nature. So we have this idea, which just goes back to the late 19th century, or a little bit later, of the doctor in the white coat, whenever white coats were invented, and the patient being extremely vulnerable, not knowing anything. Those were the days before Google, you know, when you could just look up a remedy and get everything you need to know and hyperlink, and suddenly you're asking very sophisticated questions. The state has the power to prescribe all such regulations as in its judgment will secure the public against ignorance. The public is ignorant, you see, that's presumed. And incapacity as well as deception and fraud, there's that word fraud. This is from 1888. This was a case where somebody, you might call him an early naturopath, he'd gone to an eclectic school and he got a license and he tried to set up his own practice. And the state took it away and he said, wait a minute, I have the right to practice whatever I believe in. And the court said no, under the 10th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, the state has the power, the police power, to prescribe regulations for health, safety, welfare, and morals. And these are broad enough that the state can decide who can and cannot be licensed. Now the flip side is it's also the 10th Amendment that has given the legal authority for all of the administrative regulations in rulemaking that we've talked about today. So again, the public must be protected against the menace of the ignorant, the unprepared, the quacks, and the fakers. That's true, but let's not overdo it. It's not everybody. The court must protect people against their own credulity in medical choices. 1987, this is fairly recent. Patients may not testify on behalf of their own physicians in disciplinary proceedings involving the use of CAM because patients lack competence regarding their own medical care. This is extremely paternalistic. And when I gave this talk back in 1997, just to say these things was controversial because paternalism was more in the mode and these other developments hadn't occurred. Or in Texas, the testimony of the lay sufferer with cancer is entitled to no weight. Not some weight, no weight. Or in U.S. versus Rutherford, patients who are terminally ill may not obtain a non-FDA approved drug. Why? The state of Texas is protecting these patients from exploitation. We will not allow our sympathy for the terminally ill to hinder our duty to uphold the law. Noble language, but perhaps noble only in high theory. So I said in Beyond Complementary Medicine, by the way, the other image is one that my fiance at the time, now wife, composed as a potential cover. You can see she has the yin-yang and the chakra colors with the two scales of justice. And what we emerged with was the yin-yang and the medical symbol and then the scales of justice to the side. But they used the color scheme that I liked, which was blue, purple, and white, so very appropriate to what I'm going to talk about, which is the five goals of regulation we said going up from fraud control to transformation. And so again, if we want to prevent fraud, we're on the physiological level. If we want to enhance quality, we're at the safety level. If we want to maximize autonomy, we're at the love level. Integrate knowledge, we're at esteem and facilitate human potential and transformation, self-actualization. The idea is we want to change the language from these judicial opinions to encompass all of these possibilities. So just a quote on the transformation, one flash of genius or one instant beam of revelation like a vanished dream. Heaps of pedantic dross can melt away and thoughts of century change in a day. And I think that's where we're really heading is radical transformation in technology, radical transformations in consciousness, radical transformations in how people think about what healthcare is and could be. So with that quote, let me just leave you from a concluding perspective, which is to put myself in the background, and I'll put my golden retriever first, as he sees the world. Thank you very much.